Hi everyone. Hope you all are doing great. My name is Dr. Amar Odare and I'm a radiologist. Today, I'm sharing a recording from our recent radiology webinar. If you wish to join us live for these, I shall leave links to our social media groups in the description section. Make sure you visit radiogyan.com and subscribe to the RadioGyan YouTube channel for more radiology content. Who presented massive hemoptysis, and we did a chest CT with contrast for him. I'll go through the images and then you can chat in your answers, or I will talk about them. We'll give some time for everyone to have a look at the images. As I scroll through the images, you guys can type in your answers in the YouTube comments section and then later check whether you are right or wrong. Okay, does anyone want to chat in their answers? What do you think? So this patient is a young patient who presented with hemoptysis. You can answer privately as well if you do not wish to publicly answer. Okay, so bronchiectasis, which is probably post-infective, very good. Varsha, so this apart from that, is there anything else that we see here? So what we see is, as you rightly pointed out, there is bronchiectasis, and yes, so there are ground glass, diffuse patchy ground glass opacities, which are predominantly basal, but we also see some of them in the lingula and right middle lobe. So this was a case of hemoptysis, and the differentials for this finding was diffuse alveolar hemorrhage. Also, the patient had bronchiectasis. I'll just open the soft tissue windows. So pulmonary hemorrhage, diffuse alveolar hemorrhage, Leydig-Windermeyer syndrome. So you're right. So that this patient also had Leydig-Windermeyer syndrome, as we discussed last time, bilateral bronchiectasis, and in the middle right middle lobe and the lingula. We commonly, everybody knows that we can see that in the lingula, in the right middle lobe, but it is also seen in the lingula. So this was, or that's also the right answer. So what happened is that I reported this as diffuse alveolar hemorrhage, less likely to be infective, because currently we are going through the corona pandemic. Even corona virus on imaging can have peripheral ground glass opacities, but this imaging appearance is not very typical for coronavirus. So that was very low in our differential. The main differential was diffuse alveolar hemorrhage. So I stopped at that. But that was my mistake. Like, I just gave that and I didn't think any further. It was my colleague who pointed out that there is one more finding which I should have spoken about. I'll go through the mediastinal windows and let's see if anybody can pick up that finding. So this, we did a contrast CT, and I'll go through the mediastinal windows and I'll see if anyone can pick up any additional finding in this case. I'll start from the apex of the lungs and go slowly. So people have typed in, most of your answers are right. Vasculitis. Somebody is asking, can these be cystic fibrosis? Well, if you watch our previous lectures, we have talked about this. So cystic fibrosis typically affects which part of the lung? Can anybody tell? Perfect. So Soumyadeep and Ayush have typed in the right answer, that cystic fibrosis typically affects the upper lobes. So this cannot be cystic fibrosis, but it is a differential for bronchiectasis for sure. Okay, so we have a couple of people who have typed in the right answer. So for my previous question, Salem and Ayush, I'm sorry if I'm pronouncing the names wrong. So what we see here are dilated bronchial arteries. So let me just start annotations so that for those who are not able to see these findings, they'll be able to. Okay, so if you do you guys see this artery here? I'll trace it. And okay, this doesn't allow me to. Okay, so do you see my mouse pointer? So this is if you trace these arteries, okay, perfect. So you see there are these bunch of tortuous arteries which we usually do not see in the mediastinum. Mediastinum, we are used to seeing large arteries such as the arch, the pulmonary artery, their main branches, but there are these additional dilated tortuous arteries which should not be here. So these are dilated bronchial arteries or bronchial arteries which have hypertrophied. Commonly, the lung has a dual blood supply. Most of it is supplied by the pulmonary artery. 99% is by pulmonary arteries. So pulmonary arteries are the ones which take part in exchange, the blood exchange. Only 1% is supplied by the bronchial arteries. Those supply the vasa vasorum and other supporting structures. But in cases, in a few cases, these can hypertrophy, which can give rise to bronchial artery hypertrophy. And these are the most common cause of hemoptysis. So it's interesting that 90%, 99% of the lung is supplied by pulmonary arteries, but whenever there is hemoptysis, in more than 90% cases, bronchial arteries are the cause. And this is important to know because the management. Does anybody know what is the most common management for hemoptysis as a radiologist? What is the first management usually? Perfect. So bronchial artery embolization. It's a life-saving procedure. In fact, a lot of our diagnostic colleagues are they are able to do these. Like that's one procedure if you want to learn during their residency, like an intervention procedure. If you stay in an endemic country where tuberculosis is rampant, like India, if you want to learn one procedure, that should be bronchial artery embolization. And in centers where tertiary care centers, most of the diagnostic radiology residents, they are capable of doing this procedure because it's a life-saving procedure. And if you have the opportunity to learn one intervention procedure, that should be bronchial artery embolization. So this was a case. I'll go through the MIP images also because the MIP images show these tortuous vessels better. So MIP or MIP stands for maximum intensity projection. We discussed this last time as well, but I will repeat it again. So what happens, you can imagine like in a layman's term or in a very simple term, what MIP does, it stacks a few slices together. So you see more information, so more information overlapped over each other. The problem with vessels is that they are very thin. So you may miss them in one section and the next section they are not there. So what MIP does is it combines a few sections together so that the normal anatomy or even pathology stands out well. So as you see, there are these tortuous vessels which should not be in the mediastinum on the MIP images. So apart from bronchial, so as everybody rightly pointed out, bronchial, there is dilatation, there is hypertrophy of bronchial arteries. One another interesting thing which I missed completely was this artery. If you see this artery, it is going in one of the lungs, and superiorly if I trace it, it is draining not into the aorta. Hope you are following my mouse. It's difficult, I know, on just the images, but it drains into the subclavian artery, the left subclavian artery. So this has implications in management. So what these are known as, these are non-bronchial systemic arteries, and it has implication in management. Okay, so that was the case. To revise the case, this was a case of a patient presenting with massive hemoptysis, and the cause was bronchial artery hypertrophy, presumably because of that bronchiectasis in his middle lobe and lingula. So we think that bronchiectasis is like a relatively benign finding, it's not harmful at all, and we tend to ignore it. And that's what exactly I did. And the reason I'm telling you, another reason I'm telling you that is because everybody does mistake. It's okay to do mistakes, but you should learn from their mistakes so that you don't repeat them again. I completely ignored these bronchial arteries in the mediastinum. And as you guys know, that if your brain doesn't know, your eyes won't see. So I completely ignored this. But luckily, the report was not dispatched. I went ahead and I read about it. My colleague talked more about it, and then we looked for these arteries, and then we put in all this in our report. So when it goes to the clinician and as well as the intervention radiologist, they have more information. Like, this is the information they are looking for. If I just mentioned diffuse alveolar hemorrhage, that's something they are obviously know because they can see the patient, he's having hemoptysis. So there is some hemorrhage. So we are not helping them a lot. So this way we added this information, which will help in the patient's management. Okay, so that was the case. Do you have anybody has any questions so far? Do you want me to go over the images, or because then I'll shift to the presentation? Okay, so did you guys, all of you, appreciate the tortuous vessels in the mediastinum? Okay, let me see. There are a few cause of a in a case. Okay, I'll go through that. Any cutoff for the normal size? Okay. Okay, we'll discuss all of this in the bronchiectasis is the okay. Okay. So we yeah, so bronchiectasis is the cause of bronchial artery enlargement in this case. Adele is asking what is the cutoff for the normal size. We'll discuss that in a minute. Sir, do we see bronchial artery normally? Okay, even like yeah, we'll come to that as well. Do you have any image related question? Do you want to see the images again? Otherwise, I'll move to the presentation and we'll answer all these questions. Okay, perfect. So I'll stop sharing this screen and I'll move to the presentation. So hemoptysis. We'll discuss the imaging of hemoptysis. So as I told you before, the goal is to talk about a case and then talk about the approach towards a particular pathology so that it helps you in clinical practice. It's not like I don't want to test anyone, or it's not about getting the diagnosis right. That is good up to the exam, but once you clear the exam, real life is really tough. You'll not get Aunt Minnie type of images in your real life, and you'll have to read, you'll do mistakes. So this is just to get you adjusted to that. Okay. So causes of hemoptysis, the most common causes, the top four, you can ignore the remaining ones. You have to remember the most common ones. So bronchiectasis, tuberculosis, especially in endemic countries such as Asian countries, the Western population does not have a lot of tuberculosis. Here, the most common cause is malignancy. The other the causes, chronic bronchitis. Rarely, pulmonary embolism, peripheral pulmonary emboli can cause non-massive hemoptysis. And the other important cause is vasculitis, which includes Behçet's, Takayasu's, and Goodpasture syndrome. Does anybody know which other system is affected in Goodpasture syndrome? Perfect. Ayush, Soumyadeep, Saad, all of you have said like given the right answer. So the renal system is affected in Goodpasture. You can get hematuria. Now, how do you evaluate? The initial imaging modality is chest radiograph. That will give you an overview of the pathology if there is any seen, and then help you the further management, like should you go ahead and do CT or bronchoscopy. But the ideal investigation is CT. There are a few recommendations by the Korean Society of Radiology. You can go through these. I'll share all these articles in the description section. But CT is the imaging modality of choice. Bronchoscopy has a very low sensitivity in diagnosis. And in one study, they found that only 8% of cases can be diagnosed and the cause can be diagnosed in bronchoscopy, while we can diagnose up to 77% of the cause in with MDCT. So MDCT is the modality for diagnosis. But bronchoscopy is useful for management. If they are able to identify the cause in bronchoscopy, they can go ahead and embolize that vessel. Or if they want to take biopsies, they can do that using bronchoscopy. So it's not that bronchoscopy has no role, but MDCT, that is CT, is the main modality for diagnosis. So as we did with all our previous cases, if we go through the, if we understand the pathophysiology, then understanding the pathology is very easy. I talked about it briefly while I was showing the case. I'll go over it quickly again. So 99% is supplied of the lung is supplied by pulmonary arteries. 1% is bronchial arteries. What happens, like any cause that will cause a decreased pulmonary artery flow or increased increased bronchial artery flow can cause abnormalities in the vascular system. So what can cause decreased pulmonary artery flow? So if there are pulmonary emboli, that can cause decreased pulmonary artery flow. To compensate that, the bronchial arteries will increase. In chronic inflammation, which includes bronchiectasis, chronic bronchitis, or chronic infection, and I'll reiterate, tuberculosis, this is the pathophysiology. What happens is that because of chronic inflammation, there are various inflammatory cytokines that are released, which cause increased angiogenesis. And remember, wherever there are new vessels, wherever in the body, which are due to these angiogenetic factors, or yeah, so Samyadeep said hypoxia as well. So any cause that decreases the vascular supply, so any cause in the body that causes new vessels, they are always abnormal. Okay, so we are running out of time. So I'll quickly go through so that we don't miss the entire discussion. So chronic inflammation can cause increased new angiogenesis, which will cause these fragile vessels. So bronchial, these hypertrophied bronchial arteries are fragile. And their communication with the pulmonary artery system are also very fragile. So that is why they are prone to hemorrhage. And that's the reason why in more than 90% of the cases, bronchial hypertrophy is the cause of hemoptysis. Okay, so that is the bronchial anatomy. Commonly, we have a single right bronchial artery arising from the intercostobronchial trunk, and the left one arises directly from the aorta. The important fact to remember is that they arise from T5 to T6 level. If you see any bronchial artery outside of this level, that is known as anomalous bronchial artery. And if you see a bronchial supply which is coming from a systemic artery, which is outside the like it's not from the aorta, then that is known as non-bronchial systemic arteries. For example, in our case, the vessel arising from the subclavian artery, that was a anomalous bronchial artery. And it is important because if the intervention guys do not embolize these vessels, this is a cause of recurrence. So you have to report, is are there any anomalous bronchial arteries, that are arteries arising outside the T5, T6 level, and are there any non-bronchial systemic arteries, which are arteries which are arises outside the bronchial system. So how do you identify these? Bronchial arteries will course along the bronchi, as the name suggests, but non-bronchial systemic arteries will directly go and supply the lung parenchyma without going through the bronchial artery route. So you may be like, if for example at the lung base, you may see some vessels which go via the cardiophrenic space and then that go into the lung bases rather than going along the bronchi. So this is the imaging evaluation checklist. What all do you report? You look at the lung parenchyma, you will be able to see the cause, for like for example bronchiectasis, if there's a lung malignancy or infection. So these are the common ones, and I don't want to go into in-depth imaging of like the rarer pathologies. Always remember common things you have to remember in the exam and in real life as well. Whenever somebody asks you a cause of anything, remember four important common causes rather than the entire checklist. Otherwise, what happens is that because we're trying to remember that, we forget the important ones. Then we'll look at the pulmonary arteries. Although rare, these can also be a cause of hemoptysis. As I said, thromboembolic disease can cause non-massive hemoptysis. And if there is a direct invasion by neoplastic disease, that can also cause. For example, in this case, this is a journal case where a mass is invading into the right pulmonary artery branches and causing massive hemoptysis. Okay, and then Rasmussen's aneurysm. Rasmussen's aneurysm is common, although it is not a common cause of hemorrhage, but because it's a named terminology, people try to ask it in the exams. So it is a pulmonary artery pseudoaneurysm, which can be seen in tuberculosis and can cause hemorrhage. Another named pathology is Diffus-Lipoid disease. In this, what happens, there's hypertrophy of submucosal vessels. We don't see it on imaging. It's more of a clinical diagnosis. And then coming to bronchial artery evaluation. So as we discussed, I'll reiterate again, 95% of hemoptysis is caused by more than 90%. Some quote 95 as well. Somebody asks me, what is the cutoff? So they say that 2 millimeter is the cutoff. But a simple way to remember is that if you see the bronchial arteries, then they are abnormal. Normally, you don't see it. So when you go to reporting on Monday, just go through your chest CTs. And in very, like, I don't think you'll be able to see any of these bronchial arteries. So the moment you start seeing bronchial arteries and there is relevant history, they are abnormal. As we discussed, report anomalous and non-bronchial systemic arteries, because if they don't embolize these arteries, then they can cause they are a cause of recurrent hemorrhage, hemoptysis. Another important thing which we may be able to see is, are there any bronchial to systemic artery communications? For example, and does anybody know why this is important from a management perspective? What if there is a obvious bronchial systemic artery communication? What if the bronchial artery communicates with the systemic vessels? Perfect. Swamyadeep, that's the answer I'm looking for. So what happens is that if there is a bronchial artery to systemic communication, when they embolize, some of the embolizing material can go into the anterior spinal artery, and that can cause infarction. Dr. Minu has rightly pointed out, that is known as non-targeted embolization. That covers everything which they are not supposed to embolize. So that's another important point that if you see, it's difficult, but if you see, you may report that. They talk about the artery of Adamkiewicz, which usually arises from T9 to T12. It superimposes the spinal flow, but we may or may not be able to see that. So that was the case and a short discussion of hemoptysis. I think I have answered most of your questions. I'll go through the chat again and see if we have any more questions. If you have any questions, you can type in. We have around 3 more minutes. So if you have any specific question, you can ask me privately as well. No issues with that. And I'll try to answer them. So somebody has asked, what is the protocol of CT? Protocol of CT would be the same as we do it routinely. We should do a contrast CT, and preferably a slightly early phase, but we don't want a pulmonary angiogram phase, so maybe say a late arterial kind of a phase. Okay, so somebody is asking in private about how does bronchiectasis causes bronchial artery hypertrophy. Okay, I discussed this, I'll repeat again. So what happens is that because whenever there is bronchiectasis, it is usually secondary to chronic inflammation. So chronic inflammation gives rise to angiogenesis, neoangiogenesis. It gives rise to these cytokines, which cause neovascularity. So basically, body tries to repair, and wherever there is repair in the body, it is not 100%. So that is the reason why there is bronchial artery hypertrophy. Okay, sir, cause of a bronchial hypertrophy in a case, bronchiectasis. So yes, bronchiectasis can cause bronchial artery hypertrophy and resultant. Although there can be many a times what happens is that there the pathologies overlap. Like for example, tuberculosis. Tuberculosis itself causes bronchiectasis, and bronchiectasis and itself can cause chronic inflammation, which causes bronchiectasis, which can cause bronchial artery hypertrophy. Okay, we can't recognize these on the non-contrast study. So that is the reason. That's a good question, because this patient came to me for protocol, and I was almost did a non-contrast protocol. Okay, so we just want to look for any cause. So I did a non-contrast, but then my teacher told me, okay, we should do artery, we should do a post-contrast, because we may be able to give them additional information. So we have to talk about it. So another important thing is the cause of massive hemoptysis. Pulmonary arteries can cause massive hemoptysis, especially if they are an arterial source. Okay, guys, so we are running out of time. Thank you guys for all your questions and your participation. If you have any more questions, join our Telegram group and I'll answer them there. Thank you again. Hope you guys like the video, subscribe to the channel and turn on notifications for all future video updates. If you have any suggestions, you can leave them in the comments section. Thank you.